Thank you. are gathered here today to pay our final tribute of respect to that which was mortal of our deceased loved one and friend. To you, members of the family who mourn your loss, we especially offer our deep sense of sympathy. But our hearts are reassured in the words of our Savior. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have believed in God. Believe also in me. For in my Father's house has many rooms. And if that were not so, would I have told you that I am going to a place for you? And if I go to that place, will I not come? For I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Almighty and eternal God, as we are gathered here today to show our respects, to celebrate the life of our brother, we say thank you, Lord, for the memories and the moments shared. We say thank you, Lord, for the love in the room. We acknowledge the grief and the sorrow, but we acknowledge your presence, your word that says to us that I am an ever-present help in a time of trouble. We are comforted in knowing, God, that though this body may decay, that there is a hope beyond the grave, that though we are left to mourn, Father, that there is a hope that causes our hearts to smile. Though we feel the grief in our souls, in our spirits, we can still find cause to rejoice, because we know that you are with us. For we are not like those who mourn in the world, who have no hope. We are grateful for the hope and the confidence our brother had in you. And that is what we celebrate. His faith, his life, and his legacy. For those left behind to mourn, we thank you that the blessed assurance that our brother has realized is left available and accessible to us. May we be inspired by his life. May we be encouraged by his testimony. And may we be secured in his God. This I ask with thanksgiving this blessed morning. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Would you turn with me this morning as we sing that hymn to the Lord, How Great Thou Art. My God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander,
wonder and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and see the brooks and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sins. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Last verse. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and takes me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. One more time, let's sing the chorus. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. One last time. How great thou art, how great thou art.
And that is our testimony. In the midst of the sorrow, the grief, and the pain, like Job, we declare, blessed be the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You may have your seats. I'd like at this time to welcome you all this Saturday morning And please, on the behalf of my family, extend my deepest condolences to you, the family and friends. We are here today to celebrate the life of our brother Trevor. We thank God for his life and for his testimony. We thank God for his friendship, for his love. We thank God for the memories, and we thank God for the testimony of his faith. While this is a sad day, this is a day where we reflect on the gratefulness, the gratitude of the life that we had the opportunity to share. As we say goodbye, we say hello to our own mortality. As we say goodbye, we say hello to each other. As maybe today, many are reacquainted. And as we say goodbye to our brother, I suspect also we say hello to our own dreams. As we are reminded, as the wise man said, that we ought to number our days, make the most of them. I pray that as we say goodbye today, that our hearts find a hello to our own mortality, hello to each other, and hello to the things that the Lord has stored up for us to do here on this earth. What I'd like to do at this time is invite to share with us a tribute, our brother Wendell. Would you come and share a few thoughts concerning our brother Trevor this blessed morning?
Hi, good morning. Good morning. My condolences to you, your family. I met Trevor. Trevor's really, he was a good man, a real good man. I know that many times we use that term loosely, but indeed, Trevor was a really good man. Back in 2013, I met Trevor when he was doing a Joshua Men program, a program that a lot of the men at this church and beyond this church would have gone through. Basically teaching us men how to be the best version of what God intends for us to be. And not only along the path of spirituality, but also being good fathers and good husbands and good workmates, you know, just good men in society. And during that time, Trevor would have shared his testimony. And what a powerful testimony Trevor had. Trevor was a mechanic by trade, but Trevor's calling was in ministry to men, young men and old men. His gift was ministry to men. And he totally sacrificed all of his spare time towards helping men in general, a lot of people that have the struggles and stuff that he could associate with. And he would go into prison, the prison here, he would go to all the rehab meetings, you know, and he would help in whatever way he could to encourage men in general. And me personally, I had to say something about Trevor because I had my own struggles with my family and addictions and so on. And I immediately called out to Trevor, and Trevor was such a great counsel to me. He really helped me at my lowest points, helped me to understand what I was facing, what I was seeing, what I could expect, and ways to deal with it or associate with it. And there are times that I would have called Trevor at all kind of foolish hours, and Trevor would say, "Wendell, I'll be there." And he'll come and pick me up. And he would be there with me throughout, right? This was a man who not just walked the walk, but he, you know, he just totally embraced in such a calm nature. You know, I've seen him in situations where, you know, other parties would have been very aggressive and very, you know, going through what they were going through, and Trevor was always very, very calm, you know, and be able to relate everything that they're going through, because a lot of these situations, people only like to listen to those who would have had experiences themselves, right? So he totally dedicated his life as a sacrifice to helping others. And that is something that is admirable to the max. And he loved his wife, you know. I mean, when I called to check up on Trevor, Trevor would just say, "She's here." She's here, you know. And he was all smiles, all smiles. You know, when I heard that Trevor has passed, I could just imagine him, his spirit, and I could just imagine that when he walked to the gates of heaven, he was met, and God said, "Well done, Trevor. Well done."
Thank you. Along the way, we will hear different aspects of his life. We heard just now, mechanic by trade, but a minister by calling. A mechanic by trade, but a minister to men by calling. I'm sure we all, if we were given the opportunity to reflect on this gentleman's life, we would have our own statement. It's just the character, the nature of a man, though existing in so many different spheres. I suspect though we all would have our different experiences, one common thing would stand true: the character, the integrity of the individual. What I would like to do at this time is to invite, Brittany Mears to come share with us her tribute in song.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you.
Faithfulness. Can we say that? Great is thy faithfulness. We thank you for your faithfulness. And our brother Trevor testified of that truth. I had the opportunity to sit with him in the hospital, and I heard him celebrate as he reflected through his life the faithfulness of God. I heard him celebrate as he sojourned through his memories, as he testified of relationships and moments where, without a shadow of a doubt, he could earmark the presence and the hand of God in his life. And so what exciting testimony and exciting declaration. Great is the faithfulness of God. At this time, I'd like to invite another brother of Trevor, Shamar Shuri. He made mention of the Joshua's Men program, a ministry that existed here at Hope Church that facilitated men coming together and being strengthened and encouraged through this journey of life. Though that program has come to an end, we celebrate that the relationships and the impact, as you would have heard by our brother William Wendell, we would have heard long after such, the impact and the value continues. Here is the testimony of yet another young man.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Wendell, for that touching dedication to Trevor. So when I joined the program back in 2013, I was the youngest person of our six-member group, and Trevor was the oldest. So I automatically thought, we're not going to get along. Like, I ain't got anything to talk about. Whatever subjects you discuss, I might not want to listen to. So it turned out that we actually got the closest through that program. Trevor got so close to me that Trevor was shouting my mother, my grandmother, my family more than me. He understood the assignment. I would call Trevor a day, and Trevor said, "Man, I showed your family yesterday." And I just like, "Shh, you got enough time, boy." But Trevor was that kind of person. And it is hard to let persons in your circle, especially when you don't know them. But I really got to know Trevor through that program and outside as well. And Trevor was someone that even if he was going through something and he spoke to you for 30 minutes, he would let you know what he was going through in 5 seconds. Man, I'm feeling so good, but God is good. I can get through. So you never quite understood what Trevor was going through because of his attitude and Trevor's testimony, as Wendell would have mentioned, was really powerful. I even told Trevor that I wanted to record his testimony, and anytime he's ready, just let me know, and I will record it and cut it up and put it out there, because I really believe it could save a lot of persons hearing what he went through and how he really overcome it. So Trevor's life really is a testimony to who he was. I have a friend that I didn't know knew Trevor, and when somehow Trevor name came up, my mom was like, "Wait, you know Trevor? Trevor's with me, blah, blah, blah." And I was like, the joy that he got from Trevor, it basically shows that Trevor was someone that when he touched you, you really was touched. So my condolences to the family. You lost a great man.
A mechanic by trade, but a minister to men. We just heard of him being a father to younger men and a friend to all. We want to take at this time the opportunity to invite, so I'd like to take at this time to ask to come to share with us the first scripture reading, Suzanne Agard Mears. We'll be reading from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through to 6. Let's stand for our first reading.
Just 1 second.
Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into the peace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. Here endeth the lesson.
Thanks be to God. You may have your seats. At this time, I'd like to invite to read and to present to us the eulogy, the beloved of our deceased, Miss Arlene Gail Thornhill.
Okay, I guess that's better. Well, I guess like everyone, this is a shock, and still a shock to me, that Trevor has passed away. I spoke with Trevor that Friday when he was discharged from the hospital. Actually, he was still in the hospital, and he said he was waiting for the final discharge. I was in Turkey at the time, and it was a 7-hour difference from, 8 hours from here, because time has changed, time different was in U.S. So the Sunday morning, I got a call early, right after my devotions, came downstairs to my daughter, and his granddaughter called and said, "Did you hear?" And I'm like, "Did I hear what?" And she said, "You know, granddaddy passed away." It was a total shock, because this is not some person that I heard on Friday that was ailing. This was some person who had a strong voice, was looking forward to go home, and then you hear that he's dead. But, you know, that's how life is. It's like a vapor. You know, you don't know. Today you up and about and running, and then the next thing you know, you out. You know, so I'm still dealing with that out at this point. But the comfort that I do have is to know that he's in the arms of the living God.
Amen. Amen.
And that gives me the strength and the hope. You know, Trevor, he used to say, well, for whatever reason, he thought at one point in his early Christian life, because I was a Christian longer before Trevor was. So he would say, well, you know, at least when we get to heaven, we would be still married. We would all sit there, but I say, oh, no, Trevor. You know.
we wouldn't be married. We enjoy this marriage here, but when we get in heaven, you know, there is no marriage or anything per se like that. That's, you know, we just children of the living God, and we, you know, we be praising God, and we wouldn't be in the flesh. The flesh is what causes those things, but we would be in the spirit in full. So he understood and laughed at that. But, you know, Trevor and I, this is our second going around. We were married twice, for all who don't know. When I was about 22, Trevor and I, you know, I met Trevor, you know, partying. He came to the club and we dancing and partying. And, you know, Trevor thought that he was the gift of God to all the women. You know, he was very much a handsome guy. And, you know, so it ended up that we party, we dated. The next thing you know, he moved in with me. Then we got married. You know, we weren't serving the Lord. We were young, gifted, and black. So that was what it was. And so we stayed together for like 4 years. Then, you know, he did his thing, and I went the other way. And lo and behold, you know, I went and moved to Dallas, Texas. And after a year, I came back. I said, well, let's see if this could work, this marriage could work. But I went back. I was telling Pastor yesterday, I went back, I looked for Trevor, found him, but lo and behold, when I got there, Trevor was playing Jim Romy with this, at the time she was the thing of Barbados, the queen of Barbados or something like that. So he was trying, oh, was playing Strip Romy, not quit, Strip Romy is what they were playing. So I, at that time, I just kind of left, and we haven't seen each other since then. For almost 27 years, 20-something years, we didn't see each other. And so now, you know, he has contacted me and asked, you know, said, this is your husband. And to me, it's like, when I got the phone call, I said, my husband? You know, I don't have any husband. Because this is a long time, and I didn't even recognize his voice. He said, this is Trevor. You know, I said, but we divorced a long time ago. You know. So, in any event, he would call, and then he would, you know, give, you know, he said he's now in serving the Lord, and we would talk, and then he brought up about, you know, the First Corinthians in terms of a man married, that, you know, you, unless, what would that scripture go in terms of? Anyway, the scripture was in that we were still married in Christ, even though that I had divorced. So with all of that, I kind of like say, you know what, let me go home and see if I could visit him. And I came to Barbados, and as I got off the plane, I was like, you know, Lord, you kind of like your men better than the women. I don't know why you have me coming down here to see this situation, because you know in my heart what I really want. So in any event, I came, and I got off the plane. My daughter came with me, and I got into the car, and Trevor got on his beach shirt, with, you know, with umbrellas, the girl with the umbrellas on the shirt, and I'm like, you know, Lord, I don't think this kind of work out. You know, I was ready to get back on the plane. But, you know, I share a story with my sister regarding a place, you know, Lord, he has a way of doing things. God has a sense of humor. You know, a couple months before that, I was looking for a place, and I went, the realtor took me to this place. Now, the place was awful on the outside. And I was like, well, why would you want to bring me to this place? You know, it was so badly looking on the outside. Well, anyway, she said, come inside. I got out the car, but reluctantly. And when I got into that place, it was awesome. The place was beautiful, black floors, and oh, the deck upstairs, everything was just magnificent. So when I told my sister Susie about this here, she said, that's the way you're looking at Trevor. So that convicted me. I mean, that the Lord set me up. So that was a conviction, and so from there on, that's when I yield to the Lord, and we got married
a second time around, you know. But, you know, in the midst of all of that, I mean, I don't come as often. Sometimes I come 3 times a year and whatnot. But the thing about it is that he could trust me. It wasn't no person else in my life. And I could trust him. We were devoted to each other. The only thing that was in his way with me was the Knicks. Because, you know, when it comes to playing with the Knicks, I came second. I understood that, so I took my place. But, you know, getting back to his life changing, you know, Joshua, man, I know he would talk to me because you said 2013, and we got married in 2012. And that was a very good thing for Trevor to really embrace and get into that Joshua's man, because it helped to, you know, it helped to mature him. It shaped him, you know. And, you know, he came from a lifestyle that he went down a path that his testimony, like my brother said, I mean, God has to have raised. Trevor went to hell in his life, the things that he went down the road. When I first met Trevor in New York, he drifted off. And he drifted off into a path that was really dark. And he came back here, and that was a destructive path. But glory to God. I mean, God reached down and picked him up and cleaned him off. And, you know, he took that stench from his tongue to the point of where, Elliot, I don't know if it's 17 years, if I don't remember correctly, that Trevor was clean from any drugs. You know, he wasn't involved. And who could do that? It's only the living God could take that from you. None of us is perfect. I used to take my little cocaine too. You know, none of us is perfect. I mean, I wasn't like Trevor was, but the fact is I experienced doing drugs. You know, I mean, some of us in here might have smoked your weed or whatever the case might be, but none of us is perfect. So to look down on anyone, we can't, because we're not the judge to do that. You know, we're not in that place to judge anyone. So it was really and truly when Trevor, I knew he had that calling to go to the prison and to speak to the prisoners and whatnot, but he would always say to me, you know, it's not easy here to go into the prison to do that. But his desire was really for prison ministry. That was his desire. So I just want to touch, and then I want to also say about Dawn and Sister Joan. You know, they were also very instrumental in his Christian life. You know, he would always say, you know, Joan, matter of fact, there's times that you all had events and he brought me over to your place and whatnot. But so Dawn was strong in instrumenting in terms of growing Trevor spiritually in his walk with the Lord. You know, and then he joined he joined the life group. I've been to a couple of life group ministry, but the community, right, the communion ministry. And boy, he would say, I got to get my white shirt, you know, just got to get the white shirt. So I'd constantly be bringing him white shirts because he had to get his white shirt for, you know, and even like, you know, he would say, okay, it's the first Sunday, I got to go to communion. I said, Trevor, you know, it's not a dinner. You know, in other words, other Sundays is just as important as communion Sundays, basically what I'm trying to say to him. So I just want to just say, you know, I love my husband. I am going to miss him, but there's the joy. I have my kids here in the front, you know, they're my children, not from Trevor, but they love Trevor like, you know, and he loved them. They, you know, when we'll come down and spend time with him and he will drive us around and whatnot. But, you know, I just want to say that what keeps me right now, I haven't grieved for a whole lot. Last night I had a lump in my chest, and I knew that, you know, that I went and I view him and whatnot. But what gives me the comfort is to know that he's in the hands of the Lord. Anyone here today in this chapel that have not given their life to Christ, because you don't know, you can walk out of here now and, you know, you could end up just like Trevor. The difference with him is that he's in the maker's hand. We are just here because of a body. This is the body that is fitted for this earth. But he has a body now that doesn't get any disease, no, it doesn't get any cancer, no type of sickness. And I'm saying, if the day that you know that you have not made that connection with the Lord, please, please, he's a gentleman. He's not going to force you. But also just yield and ask him. Ask him to come into your life, because there's two places. There's hell and there's heaven. And trust me, there is a hell because they talk about it in the Bible. And the Bible doesn't lie. So on this note, I say thank you all for coming, and God bless.
Amen. We thank you so much for that eulogy and for sharing your heart and sharing your beloved with us. We heard this morning so far that he was a mechanic by trade, but a minister to men in calling. We heard that he was a friend to all and a father to young men. And we heard just now that he hoped in vain for his basketball team. I had to do a quick Google, and the Knicks have not won a championship in quite some time. Maybe they will do right by you this year, sir. Highly unlikely, but we hope in his memory. But we heard of his love for basketball, but we heard of his love for his wife. We heard his recommitment of his faith, and we heard of his passion for family, his passion for ministry. Thank you for sharing that with us. At this time, I'd like to invite for our second Bible reading, Grace Agard Merritt. Merritt, my apologies. Grace Agard Merritt to come read for us the second scripture taken from John chapter 14, verse 1 to 6. Would you stand with me as we read God's word?
Good morning. The scripture is taken from John 14, 1 through 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house have many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Here ends the lesson.
You may have your seats.
Thank you.
We're now going to be blessed by a featured song by Susan Egonius. Feel free to sing along. It's a familiar song, and I suspect a testimony of the life of a man. Actually, I'd invite you to stand with me and with us as we sing this song together. Thank you. Sing that chorus one more time. The song says that he is a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Can we just say, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. So God, we thank you that you are a way maker. You are a promise keeper. And you are the comforter of those who put their hope and faith in you. We thank you for your presence in this room. We thank you that we have been able to locate your presence in our brother's life. And I pray, God, that as we left behind to journey, that we too would be able to locate your presence in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. You may have your seats. I want to leave a few thoughts with you as we prepare to bring this morning's time together to a close. Today we gather to honor and remember the life of our brother Trevor Thornhill. And we find ourselves at a unique crossroad. Whereas the memories fill our hearts and our minds, it brings with it grief and it brings with it sorrow. As we consider that which we have known and that which we have lost, our hearts feel overwhelmed, sorrowful, yet intertwined with hope. As I listened to his beloved, I locate the sorrow and the pain, but I sense the joy. I hear the sorrow and I hear how you miss him, but I hear hope. I hear a confidence. And I imagine as believers and those in this room, we may wrestle with those emotions. How can they take place at the same time? As we journey through this thing called life, and as we navigate the realities where our faith, our tears, our pain are somehow all intertwined and all mingled together, we are reminded that there is a God who has made a promise. And that promise stands regardless of what our emotions may feel or may say. I want to share a few thoughts with you and give the title to this conversation, Homeward Bound. Homeward Bound. We as human beings in this great tapestry of life, we don't like to consider the reality of the end. We live in the moment. We make plans for 10, 15 years, sometimes 20. We think of those behind us, but we rarely give consideration to the end of our time here on earth and our journey here on earth. You see, all of us from birth are on a pilgrimage towards death. And all of us on earth one day will stand face to face with this reality. But beyond this experience here on earth, there's a reality that stands far more true and far more existing and far more permanent. Because we have seen, and as we are gathered here, our friend has gone. But there's an age and there's a place where there will be no crying and no mourning. Where we believe by faith that a holy God has revealed to us that eternity is not a place simply where he seeks to dwell alone, but where he extends an invitation to humans who respond in faith to his son, Jesus Christ. A pilgrimage that we interface with many others. It's not a journey that we take alone. We heard of the testimony from Wendell Howe in his darkest times he had a friend. We heard of Wendell where in his most desperate of times he had counsel. We heard from Shamara Hall in his journey where he suspected significant differences. We heard how our brother was able to, across generations, connect and make an impact. He did not journey alone. But a few weeks ago, he took a journey that none of us could go with him. A few weeks ago, he went on a journey that no man could facilitate. As a matter of fact, a few years ago, we heard from his wife that he took a journey also where no man could go with him, that facilitated why we can celebrate. A decision came to his heart. A reality illuminated his mind and guided his soul towards accepting and acknowledging faith in the Supreme Being. His heart became awakened to the reality of a far greater truth, of a far greater person, of a far greater intelligence. His mind and his soul recognized that though he did things his own way, and there were many who clearly loved and appreciated him, that there was only one opinion that mattered. And that person carries a name. And that name is the name of Jesus. The one who took him by the hand and walked with him from that place of faith and never left him alone. The one who took him by the hand and said to him, son, welcome home. You see, we all are on this journey home. Homeward bound. It was the Temptations, I believe, in 1972 that sang a song, Papa is a Rolling Stone. Wherever he laid his hat was his home. But when he died, all he left us was alone. You see, we all are roaming and we all are on a journey. We all are navigating this reality called life. But we all, in our heart of hearts, desire a place that we call home. After a long day of work, I imagine there's no other place you want to be but at home. My family, we just recently purchased our home. And prior to that, I enjoyed roaming and liming and having fun. But there's something about paying a mortgage that emphasizes the beauty of home. There's something about ownership that emphasizes the beauty and the responsibility of home. There's something about having our own as a family that while I lived with my parents and I lived abroad in other senses and in different spaces, there's a greater sense of responsibility to maintain and to ensure that when I go home, that it is a place that is comfortable. You see, I imagine we all have a place we call home on this place called Earth. I imagine that there's a place where we enjoy the comfort and the peace of our privacy, the comfort and the peace of our loved ones, the comfort and the peace of relaxation. Of entertainment. But much like that Temptation song, there are many of us, and our brother Trevor, we locate this in his life as well, where he too was a rolling stone. Where though he probably had a place to lay his head spiritually, though maybe physically there was a place to rest and be rejuvenated for the dance, for the party, there was no place for his peace in his soul. And I suspect there are many of us in this room who we've experienced that reality. Searching and longing for a sense of satisfaction and joy that a lover may or may not be able to provide. That lasts only for a while. Satisfaction and a joy and a peace that friends may provide but only last for a moment. A satisfaction and a joy that a career, a job may provide. Wealth may provide, but last only for but a moment. Trevor experienced that, and it took him all around and engaged with so many people. But we see an experience in his life and an experience that Jesus speaks about. That regardless of what and where he had been, regardless of what and where he had roamed, regardless of what and where he had done the things he did, that there was someone beckoning him come home. There was someone beckoning him to come rest. There was someone beckoning him to come find life. Someone beckoning him to come find hope. Calling him home. And Trevor answered that call. And we heard how a life transformed. And maybe some of you know the 30-year-old Trevor. Some of you may know the testimony of a man we cannot recall. But we stand here today being able to give a testimony of a man who, not ashamed of his past, because he is aware and he stands confident that what he was, he no longer is. A man who could stand confident and say, the things I did, I do no more. A man who can say that though I rolled and though I wandered, I found my peace. And I submit to you this morning, Trevor found that peace in a person, not in a lover, not in brothers or sons. Though I imagine there was great love. I sat with him for just about an hour plus, and he spoke about you. That man loved you. And he was excited about just the thought of getting to come and be with you. But Trevor said something to me in our conversation that trumped his love for you. Trevor spoke about that same Joshua's Men program. He spoke about life group leaders and counselors. He spoke about this church. I had the opportunity to share with him where we're going. And I had the opportunity to share with him, because we too as a church, we are in transition and moving towards home. I had the opportunity to share that with him. And Trevor listened and he smiled and he said, man, pastor. And I shared with him the challenges and he said, you know, pastor, challenges will come. He said, pastor, you know, there will be things that don't go the way we imagine them to. He said, well, we just have to believe and trust God. He hinted only at his testimony, never pulled the curtain back to share. But one thing that stood resoundingly clear, something that stood, beckoned in my ears in our conversation. He knew with confidence to whom he belonged and where he called home. He knew with confidence and with reassurance of what his purpose, what his plan, what his life was on this earth. You know, it's quite interesting. I lived for 5 years in my mother-in-law's house. We married and we moved there. No, it was a place to lay your head. But it was a home. It was home, but anyone understands what I mean? Anyone ever been renting and then moving into theirs? I could not do as I pleased in my mother-in-law's house. While there was responsibility, I was not the one responsible for everything. I was not the one who had the final say. There were limitations. And while we in our lives outside of Christ may think that we can do as we please, I humbly submit to you, no, you don't. Freedom comes when one has an identity, a purpose, a home. One who wanders and one who travails the landscape of life. Though they may feel freedom to do as they wish, they really aren't. Outside of Christ, one is only bound to the chains and to the slavery of sin, to the slavery of addiction, to the slavery of pleasure. But I heard the testimony of a man who gave himself to all walks of life, who had the opportunity, or so he thought, to do as he willed. But when invited into relationship, when invited to purpose, when invited, his heart found true freedom. His heart found true joy. Your heart too can find true freedom, true joy, and true peace long before you close your eyes for the final time. This gentleman, his remains, we simply formally say goodbye. He said goodbye to us all at different junctures. But he is enjoying a freedom that knows no end. But it started long before his final sleep. Purpose found in Christ. Home found in Christ. Home found in brotherly companionship. Home found in brothers and sisters like-minded. Home found in a community. At the invitation of the person of Jesus. You see, the journey homeward does not have to be one full of despair. Though we cannot ignore the emotional impact of goodbyes. The journey homeward does not have to be one only of the experience of sorrow. Though our emotions will respond and our emotions will lead us there. A hope anchored in the promise of God's unfailing love and the assurance of eternal life through Christ Jesus. For it was Jesus himself who gave us this assurance. Not I. Jesus himself, the one whose words are life and truth, who spoke all of creation into existence. He said with his mouth, do not let your hearts be troubled. And do you believe in God? Yes, you do. Believe in me also. He says, in my Father's house. He says, at home, there are many rooms. Jesus not one to waste words. Jesus wanted to mean what he says and to say what he means. He says, if it were not so, I would not have told you so. For I am going there to prepare a place specifically designed. A place fashioned just for you. Our faith assures us. Trevor's faith assured him. His faith assures us that death is not the end. Death is not the end. Our faith, Trevor's faith, assured him that death is simply a transition from trials of this world to the eternal bliss of glory. It's a homecoming. A return to the loving embrace of our Heavenly Father, where pain and sorrow are no more, and joy reigns eternal. You know, in our last conversation, as we were wrapping up, we talked about many things. You know what he said to me? He said, Brother Trevor, I'll come and look for you next week. Because he shared what the doctor said to him. And he knew that there was a procedure coming. And he knew the possibility of there being some time for his recovery there. But he was hopeful to go home. That Tuesday afternoon, as we sat there and laughed, as I prepared to say goodbye and said, I'll see you next week, the same time, he said to me, I won't be here. He said, I'll be going home. He said, I'm not going to be here. He said, Pastor, you're not coming here to see me. You can come visit me at home. But I won't be here. I don't imagine in that statement, our brother, our friend, knew what he was communicating. That the home of homes and that his final rest where he would experience the utmost of comfort and of joy and of love and of peace, of truth, of light, of hope, as he lays eyes on the one who first laid his eyes on him. I don't suspect that when that gentleman said to me, Pastor, I will be going home, he spoke of being cared for by his daughter, being taken care of, and he looked forward. He spoke of the messages. He spoke of so many who wanted to come and visit and were waiting on him to go home. He did not anticipate. But you know what? I have found a confidence in as I replay the conversation in the mind. Though he imagined returning back to his physical home, all throughout our conversation, though he never made mention of leaving this physical earth, I could hear that he had the keys to turn a door to a mansion, that upon entering that room, there would be no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more crying, no more pain. That in that room that he had the keys to turn, that there would be no more mortgages, There would be no more bills. There would be no more disappointment, no more rejection. I located in our conversation that man knew that he had something that, come what may, he would go home. A home not built by the hands of men. A home where the papers are not owned by a financial institution. A home where a thief cannot break in and rust can't destroy. But a home where stored up for him are riches forevermore in the person of our beloved Savior. Trevor knew his home. The once rolling stone a long time ago found his home. There's some of you in this room still rolling and still searching. There's some of you in this room still navigating the seemingly cunningly rhythms and freedoms of life. But roaming, rolling. I want to humbly present to you what Trevor knew, what Trevor experienced, and what Trevor is currently participating in. Glorious freedom. Wonderful freedom. No more in chains of Cenary Pine. He stands at this present moment as he stood while here, as one who experienced the love and the salvation found in Jesus Christ. And I suspect that if he were here, he would tell you it is the best decision of his life. I'm sure if he was here, he would tell you it would be the best decision of your life to be able to take rest in the love of God and in his purposes. Would you join me as we pray? God, that temptation song said, Papa was a rolling stone. And wherever he laid his hat was his home. I don't want to live like that. That's not certain. That's not sure. That's not reassuring. That's not satisfying. God, that may be entertaining and fun all for but a moment, but my brothers and sisters who may bounce from here to there in search of a peace and a satisfaction and a joy and a hope and a fulfillment that comes from home, that comes from belonging, that comes from a safety. I am praying that we would consider what it was Trevor knew, that we would consider what it is Trevor experienced, but oh, that we would consider what it is he is currently experiencing, that we would reflect and give our minds to turn towards what it is he is currently participating, a glorious freedom, a joy unspeakable, a peace that is without ending, that is located in the face of his beloved Savior. I pray, God, that rolling stones would stop. And our hearts won't be placed anywhere as home. We heard our sister mention that there are two very real places, and we can celebrate today that our brother is in glory. God, I pray that we would be intentional, that we would be purposeful about where we lay our final rest. I pray we would be intentional, that we would be sure, that we would be confident, not uncertain like the father in this song, bouncing here and bouncing there, running there and running here. But oh, may we have a reassurance. May there be a confidence. May there be a peace, a joy, a knowledge. Now, of where home is. Of knowing that there is a place prepared that we one day can enter into. But also knowing that today there is that opportunity to rest. I pray, God, that some heart, some mind would reflect on the Trevor they knew and the Trevor he became. And may it resound in their ears and in their heart that distinct change came as a result of the person of Jesus. Came as a result of the power of the Holy Spirit. Came as a result of believing and turning away from the life once traversed. And may they be so provoked, not because of Trevor's own transformation, but because of the hope he had in Jesus. To surrender to true peace, to true freedom, and to true joy. In Jesus' name I pray. I'd like to ask the family to stand. And I'd like to ask you, would you come together at the altar? And if you would embrace each other in this moment. God, you are our refuge and our strength. You have revealed yourself to your son Trevor as a very present help in a time of trouble. You revealed yourself to Trevor as a refuge by which and whom he can run in. And so now I ask you, God, for the family left behind to mourn, though they may experience a grief and a sorrow that troubles them in the soul, I pray, in the name of Jesus, God, that you would grant unto them abundant mercy, that today you would comfort them as a healing balm in your sustaining grace. God, we humbly pray these petitions. We humbly lift this request to you on the behalf of those who loved him most, those who knew him best, those whom he loved most, and those whom he loved best. We humbly pray in the name of Jesus, God, that they too would be able to call home where their beloved is. I pray, Lord God, that their hearts would take up the faith that their father ran with. I pray that their hearts would turn towards the one who gave eternal peace, the one who brought everlasting joy, the one who gave beauty for ashes. And gave garments of praise, God, for sorrow. I pray, Holy God, as you have said in your word, that you are the God that restores our soul. You've said in your word that you are the God, but if we set our cares and affections on you, that you give to us a peace that passeth all understanding. We look to you, and I pray in Jesus' name that they will sense your presence, but far greater than sensing your presence, that they would carry your presence, much like their beloved did. I pray, God, as they say goodbye to father, to cousin, to friend, to brother, to lover, I pray they will say hello to each other. I pray that you would strengthen the bonds of love between them. I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that you would strengthen the bonds of love. I pray, God, that you would strengthen the bonds of love in this family. I pray, Holy God, that, oh, Father, that the love he had for his wife and for her children and that he had for those within his care, for his children, I pray that they will build upon it. I pray also, God, that though we say goodbye, that there will be a hello to life. I pray that dreams will not be left on the table. I pray that aspirations will not be left, God, in journals. I pray, God, that they won't only exist in conversations, but, Father, as they consider each other and as they consider their own mortality, God, I pray that they would not only number their days, but they would make most of the days that they have. And I pray, God, not just for them, but for all of us, that this goodbye would facilitate the hello to the divine orchestrator of the universe. That this goodbye would facilitate, God, a hello to the intellectual mind of the supreme being. That this goodbye would facilitate a hello to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That this goodbye would facilitate a hello to the I am that I am. That this goodbye would facilitate a hello to Jesus Christ, the King, the one who beckons us all to come home. I pray in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you. We're going to prepare at this time to transition our service as we get ready to head over to the burial. Would you stand with me? One last song we've been asked to sing is Great Are You, Lord. Let's invite the pallbearers at this time to join us. We sing this song for our recessional. Great are you, Lord. And holy, holy God Almighty, it's a privilege to worship you, Maker of all universe. It's an honor just to with a grateful heart I lift my hands to you. With a grateful heart I lift my hands to you, proclaiming, Lord, you reign. And together we say, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised, greatly to be praised. Father, you reign, great are you, Lord, greatly to be praised, greatly to be praised. Father, great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Greatly to be praised. Greatly to be praised. Father, you reign. Thank you. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end, He will stand on the earth, and after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh, I will see God. I myself will see Him with my own eyes. I am not another. And oh, how my heart yearns within me. For listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we all will be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ will be raised, imperishable will be changed. Then the saying will be written, that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up by victory. And where, O death, is your victory? And where, O death, is your sting? For the for death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God that He gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. For as much as the spirit of our departed loved one has returned to God who gave it, we therefore tenderly commit his body to the grave, in sure trust and certain hope of the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall give to us new bodies like unto his glorious body. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. And so we say dust to dust and ashes to ashes. Would you turn with me in your pamphlets as we sing the song In the Sweet By and By. Oh boy. Come on, song, can you raise Sweet By and By for me? Huh? Spirit today. And by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. Oh, in the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet in that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. Oh, in the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we will meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessing that hallows our days. Oh, in the sweet by and by, we shall meet in that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet in that beautiful shore. One more time, in the sweet. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. On the sweet by and by,
We shall meet on that beautiful shore. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and clear. And the morning breaks eternal, when the saints of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On the bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. One more time, when the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. I do pray that our testimony won't simply be a chorus, but a conviction of soul. Now, when the roll truly is called up yonder, we are found up there where our brother is at this present moment. Let us turn to page 9 as we sing together loudly and strongly this testimony. How great is our God. The splendor of a king in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, but trembles at his voice, but trembles at his voice. And we say, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. How great is our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Come and sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, How great is our God. Let's sing the chorus one more time. How great is our God. How great is our God. How great is our God. And all will see how great. How great is our God. He has the name above all names. He's the name above all names. He is worthy to be praised. And my heart will sing, how great is our God. Oh, he's the name above all names. He is worthy of all praise. And our hearts will sing, how great is our God. Okay, so I want to say thank you to, I'd like to say thank you on the behalf of the family, and by extension, extend our deepest condolences to you, family and friends, on the behalf of Hope Church. Where I had the opportunity to be his pastor for a very brief time. Our thoughts, our prayers, and our love be with you in this time as you navigate as a family. Let's all stand as we just close this morning's proceedings off totally. God, thank you for today, the opportunity to say goodbye. But thank you for today, God, the opportunity to say hello. May we really and truly say hello to each other. And may love be rekindled for family in a way, God, that time has a way of robbing us of. I pray, God, as we say goodbye, we would say hello to our own mortality, and may this encounter remind us that we too one day will face this moment for our final resting place. And so may we be provoked, God, to make the most of our days. May we be provoked to make the most of our hours. May we be provoked to make the most of our minutes. And God, may this goodbye facilitate a hello as our heart turns upward towards heaven. As the words of the psalmist, or rather of the wise man, say, to trust in the Lord with all thy heart and lean not on thy own understanding. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and you will direct our paths. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all. May you cause the light of your countenance to shine upon us and give us peace, both now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all.